Playlist Party with your host, Jason Bittner.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, everybody out there in computer land. Hope you're all having another wonderful quarantine Tuesday, wherever you are. Hope you're all safe and sound. Today, we're going to play some music for you. So I get to laze out and not actually have to go touch these things, but I would like to, but hey. Anyways, we're going to talk and play some music and talk about some of my heroes, I guess, and some of the people that have been instrumental in forming my my early drum days and forming my thought process of what I enjoyed for, I don't even know what I'm looking, what the word I'm looking for is right now, what I enjoyed in players and what drew me to certain people. So what I kind of was going to do is basically do like a little timeline sort of thing for everybody on where these artists fell in my trajectory of growing up and when I first heard these bands and, you know, how, what their drummers meant to me and what they solidified for my career and stuff later on. Yeah, we're having, this is weird having interaction with no, even though there's people out there and there's nobody right here. The last one was easier because I was just working out. So I knew my routine right here. We're just going for it right now. So anyways, hey there, Jason, sir. Hello. I did want to point out one thing before we start. I'm a proud DW pedal and hardware artist. I don't want people to forget the fact that I play Pearl drums, because there's been some, when I put these ads up, people are like, oh, when did you go to DW? When did you go to DW? I didn't go to DW. Nothing. I love DW drums, and I own a set of DW drums that are in my basement right now. I own various DW drums, but I still play and endorse Pearl drums, which I love very much. But I've been a staunch DW pedal and hardware endorser now since, oh God, 2007, I think. So it's been quite a long time. So in case anybody's wondering, still love all the companies. If I could play both brands of drums, I'd play both of them, but I can't be two people at once. Hey, if I could, I'd still be playing in Flotsam too. I'd be in Flotsam and in Overkill. Anyways, so let's get on with the music. It's very hard to pick five songs for this today too, because I've been influenced by a lot of drummers, many more than five. But I guess I would, these five are really, really important. A few of them are, you know, without them, I just wouldn't be the player I am today. I wouldn't even be sitting here. So the first one we're going to talk about, and ironically, we're going to talk about trios today. I started playing drums back in the dinosaur days, because I'm old. I started in third grade, so at that point it was 1978. But prior to that, I've been playing, you know, pots and pans, banging on garbage cans, all that kind of stuff. So by the time I got a kit, I didn't get a kit until fifth or sixth grade, and it was only a three-piece. But by sixth or seventh, no, it was sixth actually, because Ghost in the Machine came out. All right, so we're going to talk about my first gigantic drum influence, and that's Stuart Copeland. There was a lot of people who I had listened to while I was when I was a kid coming up. I mean, Kiss was the first thing that made me want to be in a band, but Peter Criss was not the guy that made me want to go be a drummer. No offense, Peter, but I wanted to be Gene Simmons. I wanted to be the guy blowing smoke and blowing and breathing fire. So anyways, I had a lot of influences when I was a kid, but I didn't really knew that they were influences per se, because you're just a kid. You're getting used to playing, you're getting into playing your instrument. You're just becoming aware of music. There's no styles yet. There's no, I want to be a jazz drummer. I want to be a rock drummer. There's none of that. It's just, I want to play drums. So there was a lot of things that were musically influencing me, but this is the first guy that made me stand up and take notice of drummers. And in 1982, when Ghost in the Machine came out, I think it was 82, 81, 82, either, whatever. When Ghost in the Machine came out, you could not turn on MTV and not see Spirits in the Material World or Every Little Thing She Does Is Magic or Invisible Sun or Demolition Man. Those four videos were in constant rotation. And Stewart's energy just, you know, took me as a kid, you know, and just the way he played and the way he was and just, you know, the busyness of the drums. I knew at that young age that this was more advanced than just typical pop music. So go ahead, Jules. Let's do it. Bombs Away. And this is actually Stewart's song, too. Great opening hi-hat part. The bass drum changes. He doesn't play the same thing twice. Ever, it seems like. I love this group. If we could go downstairs in my basement right now, I'd play it for you on my Stuart Copeland Blue Imperial Star tribute kit from 1982. Big Flam? Not yet. It comes later. When is there not a Stuart Copeland Flam? Here we go. Told you. 24-inch feisty, rude ride he was using at that time. Listen to the kick part. Hi-hat accents. Big Stuart things. Watch myself airstream. For any interested parties, too, you can actually find this song on YouTube. Stuart playing it on guitar and singing lead vocals with his band behind him. I forgot which band it was, actually, though. There's a few. I don't know if it was Gizmo or if it was the other one. But anyways, look on YouTube. You'll find it. It's a very different version with him singing and playing guitar, but it's cool. Big Flam right here. Bell of that 24-inch Rude ride he was using back then. Been trying to find one of those for my tribute kit too, but they're very few and far between. I have a 22. Awesome stuff. A lot of the Stewart things, the Flams. I took a lot of fills from him. Just the energy I took, I think I took from him a lot too. Just he beats the shit out of his drums. Still, even at this age, he does. Just awesome. I was lucky enough to meet him one time at NAMM. Me and my buddy Matty Byrne from Hatebreed, we happened to walk into the Tama Lounge to get a beer, and there he was sitting there eating his lunch. We're like, we're not worthy. So that was Bombs Away. What size and name on the bell ride cymbal? Well, what I was talking about, the cymbal that he's playing in that video at the time was a 24-inch Paiste Rude ride, which, you know, from I think the Rudes debuted, I want to say, in 79, 78, 79. I know I'm a Zildjian guy, but I played Paiste for years, and I grew up on Paiste, and most of the players I grew up on were Paiste players. So anyways, that's Bombs Away. Stuart Copeland, number one. Like I said, he was the first guy that that made me go, holy shit, the drummer's the most important guy in the band. Because we are. So he was the first guy. So that was like, you know, middle school, sixth, seventh grade. So also, back then, 1980, when MTV first came on the air, I know there's people watching this, they were like, 1980, I wasn't even born yet. Right. And there used to be this thing called MTV that showed music videos. It was amazing. It really used to be this amazing station, but no longer exists. So this gives you an idea of the diversity of MTV. So aside from the police, and this is a few years into MTV, but the first day that MTV came on the air, August in 1980, I was at my grandmother's house, and she worked for the cable company, so she had cable. I was in there for the summer on summer vacation during a day when my mom was at work, and this station came on and just played all these music videos. What is this? Like, first of all, what's a music video? And first of all, what's this station? Second of all, what's this station? So I'm watching all these videos, the Buggles, the Specials, like all these, you know, the English Beat, you know, some of the early ska bands and new wave bands and all this stuff I still love to this day. I'm a giant 80s new wave fan, ska fan, all that kind of music. It was literally from the first years of MTV. But alongside all this music was this other band that stood out. And the first day that I saw them on MTV, I just saw all these guys in black leather, these two guys with these monster masks on, and I'm like, in the name of God is this? And it said Iron Maiden. And I was like, what the hell is this? And at this time, this was early Iron Maiden. This isn't even the Iron Maiden that everybody knows, Bruce Dickinson and everything else, blah, 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 Run to the Hills. This was first two records Iron Maiden. This is Paul Di'Anno Iron Maiden. So for some of us, this is the first Maiden. I love Bruce Dickinson and I love the Iron Maiden that we all know and love, but there's something about the first two Iron Maiden records that Paul Di'Anno was on that were amazing. The songs were great, and the first videos I saw were Rat Child and the song Iron Maiden. So when I saw this band and saw this kind of music, and then I still remember this to this day because it was the first time I ever heard any kind of skank beat, two-step beat. Baku, 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 baku. Snare kick, dun, 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 dun. And that was in the song Iron Maiden. So it's got this slow, like, two-step beat. Little did I know that I would be perfecting that two-step beat at faster tempos for the rest of my life. But that's literally where it came from. That was my first foray into heavy metal. And the original drummer was Clive Burr. And Clive Burr was just a king. He was great. He was a great drummer, especially for the time he had been playing, because he hadn't really been playing drums for that long when he was making those records. And just his phrasings were cool. He had great hands and made some killer records with the band. Now, when I was getting immersed into Iron Maiden, it was pretty much almost the year, right? It was pretty much the year that Clive left. So when Number of the Beast was like the new record, he was, you know, that was when they were pretty much on the outs with him. And this was when I was getting into the band. The first new album I bought from Iron Maiden, new, like I went to the store and bought it new when I was 13 years old, was Peace of Mind by Iron Maiden with their new drummer, Nico McBrain. Now, I'm not going to say that Clive wasn't an influence on me, because Clive was a huge influence on me, but Nico is an even huger influence on me. Strictly because the guy just exuded cool. From the moment you saw him, you're like, oh, this dude's got to be cool. He just looks like he's having fun. He's an amazing drummer. And he's got a right foot that is unstoppable. One of the guys that does not play double bass, and he's very proud of that fact. And I think that's what set him apart from everybody else in the heavy metal world, was he stuck to his guns and he played one foot all those years, and he still does. And I'm able to say that he's one of my very, very, very good friends, and I love the guy to death. And I picked this song because this is Nico's favorite song. So here's Hallowed Thee by Name live with Nico playing drums. orchestral bell. And Nico, like Neil, had the actual bell on stage too. Tubular bell, not orchestral bell. You know what I mean? The big long ones. Reflecting on my past life, and it doesn't. Here's the first little added Nico. Those old feisty color sound chinas. Because on this tour, Live After Death, he was playing the old silver and black sonar kit, color sounds and roots. See, another feisty guy. Classic main guitar harmony. When there was only two guys in the band. No offense, Johnny. And I know a lot of players too that will comment on some of Nico's things, saying that he plays a lot of fills live and blah blah. But I always loved the way that he had lived on things, because I think he just livened things up, and especially on this song and this record. Which I can tell a story about this record, because I only know it from knowing the man. If anybody's seen the Live After Death video, like the actual Live After Death from 1984, this one that was on MTV all the time. Anytime you see Nico playing live, that is not live. They filmed that whole entire concert, and something happened with the cameras that were on him, and they got no footage. When the concert was over, he literally had to go back on stage in the same stage clothes and play the whole entire concert over again by himself so they could get the video footage. That's another thing I love with his fills too, is when he goes around and it comes right back around for one quick hit on the snare drum. That's one of the things I stole from him too. That snare sounds good. 14-inch deep shell. No, 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 no. 14-inch diameter shell, yes. 6.5 Ludwig Superphonic, which... Here's another interesting story. I own one of the drums that was on this tour. One of the snare drums. He had like 4 or 5 Superphonics on tour with him. He always used the Ludwig Superphonic for many, many, many years because he's a giant John Bonham fan, as am I. And I hounded him for probably a good 5 years. We used to have a place in Florida too, so I used to see him a lot close by. I hounded him for about 5 years to sell me one of his old Ludwigs, and he finally did. One day at Rockin' Ribs, he called me up. He's like, "All right, bring some money with you today." I'm like, "Why?" He goes, "I dug out one of those snare drums." I'm like, "Oh, finally." So I actually have one of the drums that was on this tour. Probably not the drum that was on this song, but the drum was physically on the tour, so that counts enough for me. Superphonic Ludwig 400. Or Superphonic 400 Ludwig, rather. See, now I'm still playing the Invisible China symbol because I'm playing the Clive Burr version. Shake it. Damn it, I can't even get it in focus. Here's another little trinket I got over the years from him, thankfully. After we did a drum clinic together in the UK in 2006, I think? No, 2005, something like that. I don't know. It's a maiden symbol. As you can see, the font. Very cool. I have one of his rides, too. He always gives me shit, too, because I don't play the things he gave me. Never play my ride symbol. I'm like, because I'm endorsed by Zildjian. They would frown on that. Ba-da-da-da! Ba-da-da-da! Awesome! Scream for me, Long Beach. Scream for me, Oxnard. All right. So enough about Nico. Anybody who knows me knows that, you know, he's my boy. So one of I never in a million years, he's one of the guys that I never thought, you know, I would be as close to as I am. I'm very, very lucky. I pinch myself to this day because I'm still super fan as a drummer. And, you know, for the most part, I've met and became friends with my heroes, which is just an amazing thing to say. So thanks everybody for being so cool. On with the show. Okay, so that was 1983 1984. So at that point in time, I don't, like I said, I'm gonna go back because it's really hard to pick five songs and five drummers, and it's very hard for me not to pick five heavy music drummers because that's what I do. But I've been influenced, and some of my favorite drummers are not metal drummers. I mean, like all the fusion guys, Billy Cobham, Dave Weko, Simon Phillips, Steve Smith is one of my favorite drummers in the world. He is my favorite drummer next to Neil. And I couldn't even include him on this list. So honorable mention, Steve Smith, Tomcat by Vital Information. Love that song. Great groove. Anything he plays is amazing. But like I said, I've been influenced by so many different people. It's really hard just to nail it into five people. But these are the five that without these guys, I wouldn't have developed the style that I've developed and be able to play what I play. So moving on. At this point, 83, 84, I'm liking heavy metal because that's what it is at that point, heavy metal. And then around 1985, I caught wind of a band called Metallica. And I went, what is this? One of my friends came in. And this was, you know, like all metal to us at that point was Judas Priest, Iron Maiden, Black Sabbath. That's what metal was. So a friend of mine brought this tape to school. And I'm like, what's this? What's Metallica? He's like, oh, it's Metallica. I'm like, okay, whatever. He's like, yeah, it's this really cool band from California. Here, you want to borrow the tape? I'm like, sure. So I borrowed, it was Ride the Lightning at that point too, 85. So I borrowed Ride the Lightning off him, and I listened to it like on my paper out the next day, and I thought it was just horrendous. I'm like, what is this crap? Sounds terrible. I just thought it was horrible. And I'm going to preface that a lot of the bands I heard for the first time that I thought were horrible turned out to be one of my favorite bands. And the band we're going to talk about next is in the same line, but we're still going to talk about Metallica first. So I get this tape and I'm like, what is this crap? So I bring it back to my friend the next day. I'm like, I don't like this. Whatever that was, it's not Iron Maiden. I'm used to listening to Bruce Dickinson or Rob Halford sing. So I'm hearing, you know, James's voice on the second Metallica record. I'm like, this is not Ronnie James Dio. This is not Ozzy. This is not the guys that sing. I don't know what this is, but it's not singing. So a couple days later, I'm doing my paper route again, and I'm in the morning. I'm just walking around. I'm humming. I'm like, what am I humming right now? And I'm like, oh my God, it's that Metallica song. So I realized at that point that I guess I didn't hate it. I really liked it. So, of course, I bought the tape again, fell in love with it, bought Master Puppets when that came out, you know, was on the Metallica train with everybody else. And I'm not, sorry, Lars, like, I'm not leaving you off the list, but Lars was an influence. Lars was the first guy that I heard play fast double bass. And fast double bass to me was Fight Fire with Fire, Trapped Under Ice on those two records. So that lit a fire under my butt. I want to do that. I want to play that like that. Like, that's great. At that point, double bass to me was the ending of Rush songs. Digga-da-ba, digga-digga-ba, or quads, blah, 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 blah. But there wasn't digga-digga-digga-digga-digga-digga-digga-digga. And I was like, all right, that's what I want to do. So Lars is the guy that put me towards thrash. But the moment that I heard this next band, go ahead, Jules. Then it was all over. Because this guy was like Lars, but on a serious Jolt Cola binge. When I heard Slayer and Angel of Death the first time, I think I literally stopped in my tracks and went, what on earth was that? Was that the floor tom like this with his hands? No, that was his feet. Oh my God. So as I said, Lars started it. But for me, the holy triumphant of metal was Lars, Charlie Benante, Dave Lombardo. Anybody who knows me knows how close I am with Charlie Benante. You know I've played in Anthrax before numerous times. You know my affinity for this man. So I just literally did a Facebook Live on the drum stylings of Charlie Benante a month ago. Everybody knows I love Charlie. And in this show, I need to give props to Dave because he was the first guy where I heard blazing double bass, because I didn't hear Anthrax until a year after I heard Slayer. And when I heard Anthrax, I'm like, okay, that's just as fast as Dave Lombardo, probably faster, but I heard Dave first. And this was the song that started all. And this is still, to me, the pinnacle of the song of metal. If you can play this one, you can play anything. Go for it. Ah! I know where I am right now. Here comes a big Stuart Copeland slam! One foot, everybody, two. One. Don't do the 2 foot gallop. Don't cheat it. One foot. In case you don't know, the kick pattern is 1-3, 1-3, 1-3, 1-3. 1 foot, not two. Two 10. At 205. But in 1986. 1986. I know there's guys that play faster. Doesn't matter. These guys started it all. Here's another YouTuber for you guys to go check out when you're done here today. Go check out Jason Bittner, drum cam of Dave Lombardo playing Angel of Death, which is under, I think I put it up under, it's probably under Dave Lombardo drum cam. Yeah, just go look for Dave Lombardo drum cam, Angel of Death, Metal Allegiance last year at the House of Blues. I literally was, 4 feet away filming the whole thing. Dave's a longtime friend. Good to see you too, Kevin. Dave's a longtime friend. I've known Dave since, 1990. A long, long, long time ago. Still one of my all-time faves. 15-inch Peisty Rude hi-hats. Sound Edge. All Rudes on this recording, actually, I think. Another interesting one is going back. If you want to see a bunch of drummers playing this, go back and YouTube Jason Bittner, Derek Roddy, Gus Rios, Angel of Death at NAMM. We did it at the GoPro booth, the first year that GoPro had a booth. 2008, maybe. So three drummers playing Angel of Death. Well, I played drums in those two guys playing guitar. Some of the most evilest riffs ever. Rest in peace, Jeff Hanneman. One of a kind. Here comes another big Stuart Copeland slam. One foot. Accent the cymbals on the one. Big roll. Two accents. Fill. Here we go. All you young kids can go blast away at 280 all you want. It doesn't get better than that. Now I'm sounding like a crotchety old man because I can't do that stuff, but seriously, no, I'm kidding. I wish I could play 280. Anyways, no, I really don't, because if you don't have any reason to use it, then what's the big deal? Just say I can blast at 300 BPMs. Well, do you use it in your band? No. Well, then big deal. Okay. Anyways, I'm digressing right now. Dave Lombardo, one of a kind. So those are the thrash days. That's really where it's, like I said, it's hard. Now we're stopping my influences at 1986. That was a long time ago. There's been plenty of drummers that have come in that realm since then. Sean Reiner, Pete Sandoval, Gene Hoagland, Nick Menza, Gar Samuelson. I'm going to sit here and name all the names that everybody knows. But as I said, we were talking about the main ones that were most important. So this next guy is the only guy who is past the year 2000, believe it or not. And the reason why I need to bring this up is because this is another example of when I heard a band, I went, what on earth is that? Oh my God, this is so awesome. Like, this is amazing. The drums are so great. The drums fit with the music perfectly. The music's awesome. It's kind of heavy, but it's, and I, once again, I don't want people just to think if it's not heavy, I don't think it's good. That's not it at all. But it was just the way that they took all these elements. I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. And the band I'm talking about, Jules, Porcupine Tree, Gavin Harrison. Gavin Harrison is the one guy on this list that came after 1986. And the first time I heard this record, I was just like, oh my God, this band is just so good. The drummer is so good. And this is about maybe a year before everybody started hearing about Porcupine Tree and about Gavin and how great Gavin is. Gavin's a great player, great guy. We did a drum festival Stick It to MS thing we did together in the UK, I think in 2008, maybe something like that. 2008, I think it was. And we were playing in Birmingham at the time, and my flight was out of Gatwick or London. I think it was out of Heathrow, actually. Well, long story short, is I had a 2-hour taxi ride back from Birmingham to go to London because I was flying out of London the next day. And Gavin's like, well, why don't you just ride back with me? I'm driving back to London now. I'm like, really? He's like, yeah. So we had a great 2-hour car ride back to London, just talking drums and life and everything. And he's been a great friend ever since. I also want to point out that Neil Peart loved Gavin Harrison. Probably because he probably heard some similarities there. And that's another thing, too, is Gavin just had that such tasteful style of drumming, just like Neil. Go for it, Jules. Sound of Muzak. Great riff in 7. And finally, some Zildjian cymbals. Oh, we get subtitles, too. Elevator Prozac stretching on 4 miles. And like I said, Zildjian guy, Zildjian guy. It's only meant to repress and neutralize your brain. So that's the next one. Papa Butts. One of the best lines ever. Yeah, the music business is going down now. Then it's really gone down now. This is actually the song that Neil talked about in an article one time before, too, about the demise of the music business. Now the sound of music comes in silver pills. Engineered to suit you, building cheap thrills. The music of rebellion makes you want to rage. Here comes the open eye app, though. I got it that time. I did write, I did a cover story, I think, for Drum Magazine back. It's on the wall up there. 7, something like that. I don't know. It was shortly after this record came out. And I had listed it as one of my, top 10. And I had just said, one day I'd like to be able to play the opening beat to the Sound of Muzak. I really did learn how to play the song, in case anybody's wondering. I soon forgot, probably 6 months later, but I did eventually learn. This part right here, if there's any King's X fans, that riff always reminded me like the beginning of Summerland. Oh no, Lost in Germany? No. Summerland or Lost in Germany? I can't remember that. It reminds me of the beginning of King's X song. Lost in Germany. Such a good drum sound, too. Listen to this fill that he does when he comes back in. It's one of those, what the, huh? It's one where I just go like this and just get everything around the drums and it sort of sounds like it. Gavin's the man. He's like the, I can't call him the second coming of Neil, because to me that was already like one of my other early influences, Mark Zonder from Fates Warning, who in the late 80s, I really thought he was like the second Neil to me. Very, very, very Neil-like. Which brings me to my last song. I bet you guys don't know what band I'm going to talk about. I'm wearing a shirt. I've been talking about this guy incessantly for the last hour. In case you don't know, I love Neil Peart. He's my favorite drummer ever. He always will be. And thank God I got to be friends with him. Oh, I still can't believe that. Oh, thanks, Lauren. Thanks to my friends at Atlantic. Thanks, Robin Paul at Hudson Music. I love Neil Peart. Okay, so I had to definitely talk about one of DW's biggest artists ever, and that's the icon. That was Neil. I told you I own DW drums. And this is one of my, I never know where that stupid camera is. One of my prized possessions, the Icon drum. And that's my favorite badge right there, the Grace Under Pressure. That is gonna, soon is gonna go right there on that arm. I love this drum. I don't use it much because I don't want to mess it up. I keep him stored here safely in my studio. Hey, here's another memorabilia that I just happened to look at. I was talking about Iron Maiden. Well, I guess we could bring you real close, real quick. Oh no, we'll disconnect the audio if I do that. Okay, so right there, that is a guitar signed by everybody in Iron Maiden. Yeah, the real band. And that is a guitar signed by everybody in the real Black Sabbath. And when I mean the real Black Sabbath, I mean the four original guys. Those are my two prized possessions from Ozfest 2005, when we were lucky enough to tour with both bands. So yes, I have a Maiden and a Sabbath guitar hanging in my studio, which is pretty freaking cool. Neil Peart, I can't say enough about the guy. I really can't. I don't really think I have to at this point. It's been said already. I've said it enough. I miss him tremendously, and I know my good friends at DW miss him too. So before I start crying, let's listen to the greatest fucking drum solo ever. Back in the old days on Zildjian cymbals. Before he went to Sabian, but he was a longtime Zildjian player, and also on his days of his giant super mahogany Tama round superstar kit. If you need any information on any of those, hit me up, because I know it. I know it from piece by piece, from the start to the finish, because it's being built in my basement right now as we speak. Only missing one drum. I have to have one drum recon. I'm not going to talk over my hero. I will say that this is probably I still think this is one of the greatest bass and snare drum sounds ever. The drums just sound so amazing, but the kick and snare still to me are my favorite, probably my favorite kick and snare sound ever. And that was his Slingerland Artist snare drum, which I have one of those too, that he personally signed for the first one. Wuhan, China. Like, I just put a picture up the other day. Big Red. Well, you can see the giant band. think I unplugged myself. I did. Ding, ding, ding. So what I did say before you didn't hear me was I loved that fill back a few fills ago. It's another one with just one snare drum hit that throws it all off. Now, how many people out there are going, na 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 na, because they're used to listening to Moving Pictures? All right, anyways, there you have it. There's my five songs. Neil's still the king. He will always be the king to me. And there you go. But, you know, if we had time for one more song, if we did, it would definitely be something by Led Zeppelin, because actually for me to leave out Bonham is kind of a travesty. But it's Gavin's fault. But Bonham was just as much influential on me as Stuart and Neil. But it's really hard to just, you know, like I said, pick five guys or five songs that are, you know, encompass 40 plus years of drumming. I've probably had five influences within the first, you know, 6 months of drumming. Who knows? So anyways, that is my stream for today. I'm going to get back to this mess of a studio I have here. As you can see, I got all this stuff behind me. I'm trying to get my Twitch channel going so I can get out there and stream live for everybody, since we can't get out and play live because of this stuff that's going on. So anyways, your next episode for DW's Playlist Party will be July 2nd at 10 a.m. Pacific with my good friend Stanton Moore, who is always busy. Always busy, Stanton is. DW.com Drum Network. www.dwdrums.com/drumnetwork. You can find all of these videos that we've done. The playlist parties, the Fitness Friday ones, in case you missed my workout a few weeks ago. I wonder if anybody did do that, and how many people were sore the next day? Send me an email. All right. So I'm just going to leave you all with thanks a lot. Thanks to my good friend Jules and everybody over at DW Drums and all the rest of my endorsers too. Pearl, Zildjian, Remo, Promark, Gator. I don't want to leave those people out because they help me keep going every day. New Overkill album is in the works. I'm slowly making it through the demos here. We were supposed to be tracking 2 months ago, but due to this, we were allotted a little bit more time to work on stuff. So I'm back to working on that. I was going to sadly tell you there was going to be a Shadows Fall reunion this year, but that didn't happen either due to COVID, like a lot of things in life. So I just hope that everybody out there stays safe and sound and healthy, and don't be stupid. Wear a mask. Wear a mask. Just do it, because the longer that the one person out there goes, oh, this doesn't affect me, is the longer that we're all stuck inside. So be safe, be smart, and I hope you all have a great day, and let's get through this together. Peace.